Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
Hello students, welcome once again to Prudence Scholars, one of the best initiatives in the field of education in Goa by Prudent Media and our own Principals Forum. I welcome you today to my today's class on a simple and very easy topic from 12th standard biology syllabus point of view, but very important topic from which has relative importance to our mother earth. That is my topic today, is biodiversity and its conservation, and I am your teacher for today with this lesson. I am Shubhada Acharya Shirodkar with my lesson. So first of all, I would like you all to watch the video that I have made, a just 2 minute video before I start with my class. We have seen the different types of organisms that we saw on the screen. There are birds, there are animals, there are plants, there are trees, there are so many different types of organisms. So here I would like to use one same line from the textbook that is there, that if some alien descends on this earth, the first thing that will amaze and baffle that person or that alien, which is the actual real organism here. There is so much of life on this earth. There are so many different types of organisms that are there, that it is a very, very amazing thing to see. Now, the first thing that I would like to tell you all from this, the chapter that is starting, biodiversity and its conservation. Life originated about 3.8 billion years ago, and it has been continuing till date. We can see life in a very small ant, and also in a very magnificent tiger, as well as we can see life in a small encrustation like moss, rickettsia, what we see on the walls, and also in a huge trees like oak trees or banyan trees, peepal trees. These are huge trees, sequoia trees, where life is existing. Now, the term that is actually for your studies now, that is biodiversity, biological diversity, and that is the short form. Biological diversity term was taken first by W.G. Rosen way back in 1985. Then he had coined it, but later on it was popularized as biodiversity by who is also called as father of biodiversity, that is Edward Wilson. Okay, that was in 1988 when he published some articles and he represented them at a convention. Now, the definition of biodiversity is very simple. Okay, it is just the number and types of organisms present on this earth. It's just the number and the types of organisms that are present on this earth, and it also refers to the sum total of diversity that exists at all levels of biological organization. Okay, all levels of biological organization means which are the different levels? There are three levels at which we study biodiversity, and they are the three levels of biodiversity. Of that, the first one is genetic diversity. Now, here genetic diversity means the genes. We know that all our characteristics, all our traits, all our characters that we portray from outside, they are all controlled by genes, and these genes are many in number in a particular species. The second one is species biodiversity, that is different types of organisms, and the third one is ecological biodiversity, that is different types of ecosystems. Now, we'll see the genetic diversity first. Now, that one example that is highlighted in your textbook is of genetic variability in case of rice. Now, rice is one individual species, but the genes, the strains that are there of different types of rice are 50,000. 50,000 varieties of rice are available. Now, we can see the picture of the different types of rice which is available, as well as the genetic variation in case of Rauhnia vomitoria, that is found in the Himalayan regions, that the genes in this plant vary, and because of this variation, there is the potency of reserpine, that is the drug that is available from this plant which is taken, and also we see genetic variability in the most delicious fruit, what we call the king of fruits, that is the mangoes. There are so many different varieties of mangoes available, and this is all because of the genetic diversity. Now, this genetic diversity helps the organisms to adapt to the different types of environments in which they are placed. The second one that is there is species diversity. Now, species diversity, these pictures that you see, they are all taken here itself in our Goa. So, the pictures that are there, they show different types of birds, a few type of plants, the flowers, the variety of flowers that are available, they are the species. Now, species diversity is the different types of organisms which are present in that particular environment. Now, in this case, the species, and what happens is, in this species diversity, one more example that I can give you is in the Western Ghats. In the Western Ghats, we see immense species diversity in case of the amphibian species, that is the types of frogs that we see from a single genus. There are a variety of examples that are available. That is the species diversity, the level of difference that is there in species diversity. And the last level of biodiversity is the ecological diversity. Now, this is simple. You can see that in India itself, we have different types of ecosystems. One is we see deserts, we see this aquatic, oceanic environments, then we see forest land, we see grasslands, we see different types of environments, and these, because of these different types of environments, we see different types of organisms which live in this. So, biodiversity is also because of the difference in the land pattern or the water patterns that are there, and because to adapt to these different types of places, different types of organisms are seen. The next topic that is there in your this is about the different the gases that are there. A wild guess is that about the number of species which are actually there. If you just go out and start counting the number of organisms that you come across, okay, there will be several different types of ants, there will be different types of insects, there will be different types of birds, plants, the variety of organisms. If you just go out of your house, now each and every one, the name and the record of that particular organism, whether it is made or not made, we are not sure. Whether it is recorded or not, we are not sure. So, we can see that eukaryotic species. Now, here I am talking about eukaryotic species. The report which came in 2011, it is estimated to be 8.7 million species are there, plus or minus 1.3 million, that is the report. According to your textbook, this which is published, that shows that about 1.5 million species are already recorded. 1.5 million. But according to the estimates by different scientists, because the forest like Amazon and all, there are about lakhs of species which are not recorded. There are millions of insects which are not recorded. So, according to that, they have made estimates. Now, this one of the estimates which is made is by Robert May, that he says that there may be about 7 million species on this earth, and what is sad that about 80% of the species are not yet recorded. So, we, and mind you, these millions what I am talking about, this is only about eukaryotic species. We have not considered here prokaryotes. So, there are different millions of bacteria and all which will be surviving on this earth. Now, India, talking about India is one of the 12 mega diversity countries in the world. Although we have a very small area in case of the land area is only small, that is 2.4% of the total land mass of the world, but the diversity that we have according to the global, this 8.1% is belonging to India. So, that is the global species diversity that we are contributing to. Now, this, because of this major part of ours in contributing to the biodiversity, we are having hot spots. Now, in case of India, we have the hot spots of Himalayas, wherein there is lot of indigenous species. Then we have the Western Ghats, the Indo-Burma and the Sundalands. Even our Andaman Nicobar Islands which are there, they contribute to the biodiversity and island specific species which are called as endemic species. Endemic species are species which are present only in that area and not anywhere else. This is our biodiversity hotspot map which we can see, which shows the four different areas that are there: the Himalayas, the Indo-Burma region, the Western Ghats and the Sunda land. Then according to the species, now what we said above, we are talking about millions of species, not one or two or hundreds or thousands. Now if a pie chart is made only of the invertebrates, invertebrates, as you know, they are the species which do not have a backbone, okay. If we consider them, the insects, they form more than 3/4 of the, about 70% of the animals that are recorded are insects. That means out of every 10 animals if you record, 7 will be insects, and the remaining, that is mollusks, you know, they are like bivalves, you know, and the gastropods, they are all mollusks. Then crustaceans, those which have a carapace. Then other animals like mammals and all, they are considered still smaller groups. In case of vertebrates, okay, in case of vertebrates, we have which with the backbone. Now with the backbone, there are the fishes which make the maximum number of species, along with the mammals, the birds, reptiles and the amphibians. The second major group is the birds. You can see that there are thousands of species of birds existing in the world. Then we have the plants, okay. In case we combine plants and the fungus together, then fungus and the flowering plants that we call as angiosperms, they form the majority of the existing flora of the biodiversity, then followed by algae, mosses, ferns and the other like lichens. Now when we have this so much of biodiversity, how is it distributed on this earth? How is it distributed? Whether all the areas throughout the earth, whatever land, whatever marine waters we have, are all the organisms distributed equally on all these areas, or whether there are some patterns of division? Now in case of this, the first one that is there is called as latitudinal gradients. Now here you have to remember what is a latitude. Now latitude, only here I would like to use the chalkboard, that is for showing you, just to revise your a little bit geography that is there, if you all do not remember. If I draw the earth, okay, now this is the equator, okay, this is the equator, and this is the Tropic of Cancer, and this is the Tropic of Capricorn. Now here is the Arctic Circle, and here is the Antarctic Circle, okay. Antarctic Circle, Arctic Circle, the Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. Now only what I have to highlight here is the area from here to here, it is called as the tropics, and this area is called as the temperate area, is called as the temperate area, this and this, and this is the polar region on both the sides. Okay, now as for the latitudinal gradients, what we call, okay, we can see that the tropical area which is there, the tropics have the maximum number of species. Even generally you must be realizing that tropical country, and whenever you have thought about the polar regions, there are very less number of species. As you move from the, as you move from the equator towards the two poles, the number of species keeps on decreasing, and it is maximum in the tropical area. So why is this happening? What must be the reason for the tropical region to have more number of species than the polar regions and the temperate regions? There are three hypotheses which have been put forth. One of them, the first one, is that the tropics are relatively undisturbed. Now, what does this mean by relatively undisturbed? That is, means the temperate regions and the polar regions have been subjected to periods of glaciation. You must have heard about ice age, okay? So, ice age means the whole area gets covered with ice and it remains for a long time. Now, earlier also there were ice ages, okay? So, when it intermittent, in between there are periods, and this now what we are having is an intermittent period. Now, these areas, the temperate areas and the polar region, they were subjected to this glaciation periods, and the species could not, they could not stay there, they could not adjust there for that period of time, and they had to become adjusted. By the time they become adjusted, the new glaciation period comes up. So, that is why the tropics are not disturbed by this glaciation period. Maybe because of this, we have in the tropical area more number of species than the other areas. Then the second reason that is given is tropics are less seasonal. Means even when you must have observed that when we have winter here, what about the winter here and what about winter in European countries or in the polar region? There winter is full of snow, whereas here in case of us who are staying in these areas, tropical areas, the winters are not very cold. We can adapt to that. Whereas even the other seasons, the seasons which are there, there is not much variation in these seasonal days. Whereas there, the seasons which are there, they are contrasting to each other, the environment contrasts. If there is autumn, totally there are no leaves on the plants. It doesn't happen in case of tropical areas. Okay, that is why it is called tropics are less seasonal. Okay, that is why it is said that tropics are less seasonal. That is why maybe the species can adapt more, because there is not much variation in the seasonal changes. Then the third one is that tropical area gets more sunlight directly. This is known that in near the equator and in the tropical region there is more sunlight, so maybe more productivity, because plants will produce more sunlight, so more production. So maybe more species survive because there is more food. So that is the third hypothesis that is there. Then the second, this is about the species area relationship in case of patterns of biota, how they are distributed. What is said in this is, when you consider a single region, the if you count the number of species, then as you move, keep on counting, they will keep on increasing. The species richness will keep on increasing, but up to a certain limit, that is within that particular environment. The number of species will not keep on increasing. It will stop at a particular place. Now, that is species area relationship. Now, the relation between the species richness and area for many birds and flowering plants, it is like initially it is slow, then it increases and then it remains. It is called as a rectangular hyperbola. Now, the same thing mathematically, if it is plotted on a logarithmic scale, it shows a straight line, okay, it shows a straight line. That is species area relationship. Now, what is the why? Now, we have seen that there are so many species. We have seen that how they are distributed on this earth. And now we have to see why, what is the importance of all these species to us. Now, communities with more number of species generally tend to be stable. They are stable communities. And so what happens? The productivity is more. When there are more number of plants, more number of green plants, the production will be definitely more. As well as when they are resistant to natural or man-made disturbances. Now, natural disturbances may be anything like extra heavy rainfall, or it may be droughts, it may be floods. These are all natural disturbances, and also man-made disturbances like pollution and all that. If there are more number of species, then there is a risk that most of them will survive, although some of them may disappear. Then one more thing is that they are resistant to alien species, invasion of alien species. That is why more number of species in this environment are required. Then does it really matter to us if a few of these species, what we saw, so many insects, so many birds, so many, why do we require them? Are they really important for us? They are important for our ecosystem health and balance, okay? And as well as ultimately what is important for us is, it is important for us to survive on this earth. They are important for survival of our human race. Now, this is whether I just asked one question. Does it really matter to us if a few species become extinct? Extinct means they just disappear from this earth. Now, that is explained very nicely to us by Paul Ehrlich. Now, what he says is, he has put forth a rivet popper hypothesis. Now, here in this picture, you can see that these are parts of an airplane. Now, all these parts of the airplane, they are fixed together by small structures which they call as rivets. Okay, now Paul, what he did is, he put it as an analogy that these rivets are the species and the aircraft is this earth. Okay, now what he said is, if every time a passenger sits in the plane and wants to take one rivet as a souvenir, every passenger wants to take a souvenir, every time one is taken, nothing will matter, because you can see that there are so many which are there. So, one taken, two taken, three taken, it doesn't matter. But when there are many which will start disappearing, what will happen to the plane? So, that is what he had put. And also what is important is the place from where this rivet is taken. If it is taken from the wings, it is dangerous. But if it is taken from a window pane or the from the seat where you are sitting, then it will not matter much. But it also depends which species disappears. Okay, so that is how this importance of our biodiversity, means the number of species which we require, is made by Paul Ehrlich. To continue with the same thing, that is extinction. Now, since the origin of life, what we have faced is five episodes of extinction. Now, five episodes of extinctions which have taken place earlier. Now, we are in the sixth episode of extinction. Now, sixth means, now slowly our organisms, our species, they are disappearing. Earlier what had happened, that was natural. Even in the Cretaceous period, we have seen that the dinosaurs, they completely were washed off. So that is one of the extinctions. Now here what is going on now is called as the sixth episode of extinction, and the only difference between the earlier five, the earlier were Cambrian explosion, the second was Carboniferous, third was Permian, and the Cretaceous was the one which the dinosaurs disappeared. And now what is happening, the difference is that it is 100 to 1000 times faster than the earlier ones. So within another few thousand years, it is said that all the species may start disappearing. Now these are a few examples of what are mentioned in your textbook. I am restricting myself because biodiversity is such a chapter that we can give n number of examples and different things, but I have to restrict myself to the only the topics which are mentioned in the chapter. So these are examples which are mentioned in your textbook, that is the dodo bird, the kaga, the Stella sea cow. The Stella sea cow was a very huge animal which was just lying on the islands. It is like a cow, it's a very slow moving organism, and it was hunted, so much hunted for food that the last one also was hunted and eaten, and there are no more sea cows. Then the thylacine from Australia, and this is about these tigers, the Caspian, Bali tiger, the Javan, they are no more to be seen on this earth. As well as there is one more, that Asiatic cheetah, the fastest mammal on this earth, is extinct from India at least. It is not there, it is found only in one place, I think in Iran. Okay, so that is this of animals and birds which are becoming extinct. Our children will not be able to see this majestic animal which we used to call as the cheetah, which was there earlier. Now, loss of biodiversity, what will happen if these species are lost? First thing is plant production will come down. The second thing is they will not be resistant. When many are together, they are resistant. When they become less in number, they become less resistant. And the third one is the whole pattern of our rain, now we say rains, heavy rains, either heavy rains or less rains, then the whole pattern of this will change. Our cycles will start changing. So that is what will happen if biodiversity loss is there in any region. Then now, what are the causes of loss of biodiversity? Now these causes are broadly placed in four major reasons or four major causes, and it is together called as the evil quartet. Now, evil quartet, first one is definitely habitat loss and fragmentation, and which is the most important one. From the word itself, we can make out habitat loss means destroying their houses, means the organisms' houses, and fragmentation means making pieces of their houses wherein the forests are cut. Every time we are having some project like building a dam, or we want to put up an agricultural place, or we want to develop a land for some industry, what is done? First thing what is done is the forests are cut. So what will happen to the animals and plants which were there? They will be devoid of their houses. Second reason is fragmentation. Organisms which move over a large area, like elephants, tigers, they require large areas to move. There are water holes and all. If we make a small part of the forest is cut, then if the water holes are there in those places, then the organisms will suffer. The species which depend on this water will suffer. And pollution also is another reason for this habitat loss. Okay, so as well as in some places like the Amazon itself, for growing soybeans, there are wild areas which are cut down, forests are cut down, and animals which are staying there, they either move from this place, and if they can survive in that other place, they will survive, or they will be dying out. Like this, if patches are cut out, and animals, they lose their habitats. Then the second reason is over exploitation. Now what is over exploitation is, it is said that human beings or nature provides for everybody. If we do not disturb any environment, we get everything for our need. What do we require as food? We just require a meal twice a day, proper balanced meal twice a day. But nature cannot provide us for our greed. Even if I need two times of food, our houses will be stocked with the food that is required for a month. But even in nature, the same thing happens. When we take what is more than what is required, especially this is happening in case of marine fishes. Many marine fishes which are there, they are becoming extinct because of over exploitation. What happens is, when we dredge or when we use the net, there are different types of fishes which are coming. Only those fishes are taken out which are required as food. But what about the others? They are just left, even which are not required, they are just left into the, on the seabed or on the seashore to die. When we harvest fish, okay, what is done is, only the good ones what we need are taken, and the remaining, they are just thrown out in the this. So because of this also, there are many species which are lost of marine species. So human beings should take care that we take only for our need and not become very greedy. So, and the next, this is alien species invasion. Now in case of alien species invasion, alien species are other species which do not grow in that particular area. They are not native species. So when deliberately some species are introduced, so what happens is, they, because especially when they are animals, because they do not have a natural predator. Like for example, Nile perch, it was introduced in the Lake Victoria because there were too many fishes of those cichlid variety. Now what happened is, it ate away that variety as well as it ate away the others also, because this Nile perch did not have anybody to eat it. It did not have a natural predator. So that is why exotic species, when they are introduced in environments, they create havoc to that particular environment. Also you can see that Chromolena, it is also called as Congress Gavat in case of our local languages. It is growing so much in all our cashew plantations, our roadsides, even our, it has started invading our individual home gardens, because the flowers of this, they cannot be destroyed very easily. It is just growing as a wild weed, and it is supposed to have come from some packaging from some other country. So that is also a exotic species, and it can survive any, very sturdy it is, and it can survive any condition without even water for a long time. Even these are some of the exotic species or the alien species which are invading. Like for example, water hyacinth. Water hyacinth Icornia was introduced in the waters to reduce pollution. But what it did was, it grew so fast in the waters that it started clogging the waterways, the pipelines and all which take water. It started growing in that also. So that is the water hyacinth. Then the last one is co-extinctions, the reason for biodiversity loss. First was habitat loss and fragmentation. Second one is alien species invasion. Third is over-exploitation, and fourth one is co-extinction. Co means together, and extinct means become extinct together. When some species are bound together by obligation, some organisms stay together. Like for example, there are some fishes with whom some parasites they stay. They stay on those fishes only. Now, if the fish become extinct, the parasite also becomes extinct. Like some isopods, which are which have obligatory relationship with a snapper fish. So these two, both of them together, if one dies, the other one also will die out. One example is here is this example which is given in your textbook, that is the yucca flower, yucca plant, and the pronoba moth. For pollination, this yucca plant requires only that moth. If the moth is not there, then the flower also will not survive, or if the flower is dying out, the plant dies out, then even the moth will die out, because it can survive only on that. That is called as co-extinction. Then now we have seen that there are so many species. We have also seen that they are becoming extinct. We have also seen the causes of biodiversity loss. Now we have to see what we can do. Why do we have to conserve this biodiversity? The first one is narrowly utilitarian approach. Now, what is this narrow-mindedness? In short, we can call it narrow-mindedness, selfishness. Because I want food, because I want my medicines, because I want my drugs, the medicines which come from the plants and animals. Because of that, I have to preserve them. Second is broadly utilitarian approach. Because the biodiversity gives so many ecosystem services. That is, the oxygen is replenished on this earth because of organisms. Then we can see that different processes like cycling, nutrient cycling, that is because of this biodiversity. Then the third one is also pollination services are given by the organisms, different types of organisms. So that is a broadly utilitarian approach, because everybody is benefited. Then the third one is ethical approach. Now this ethical means according to our values that we have, the morals that we have. This earth belongs to all of us. We are just one species. Human beings are just one species which belongs, which has a right to stay on this earth like other animals, other plants, and even the microbes which are staying in the soil. They have equal right for staying on this earth. So who are we to disturb their houses? Who are we to destroy where they are supposed to stay? They can equally stay on this. So that is a ethical approach, because we have to live together. That is, these are the three approaches for why we should conserve biodiversity. Then now that we know that biodiversity loss is there, that we should conserve biodiversity also, then how do we conserve biodiversity? How can we go about protecting our nature, protecting our wildlife, protecting the other species other than human beings? The first approach is in situ. In situ means in the situation where they are. Wherever they are, you make them stay safely. This approach, and the second approach is ex situ approach. Now, ex situ conservation means exhume them, remove them from the place where they are, take them to a protected area and protect them. Keep them in a place where they can be safe, because they are not safe in their natural habitat. Remove them from there and place them somewhere else. That is called as ex situ. The first type of conservation, that is there in situ, the first one that is there is biodiversity hotspots. I told you in the earlier topic, we saw what is a hotspot. Hotspot is a totally protected area where there are maximum number of endemic species. Endemism means that particular species is present only in that area and nowhere in the world. That is called as endemism. The second one is biosphere reserves. Okay. Now, biodiversity hotspots, we have seen earlier there are four hotspots. Okay. In case of biosphere reserves, They are big protected areas which are there. We have about 14 in India, where along with the tribes and all, whichever human beings they are staying there, the whole area gets protected. Then the second one is national parks. National parks, we have about 90 national parks in India, I am talking about in India. And in these national parks, other than wild animals and plants, nothing else is allowed. No agriculture, no nothing else is allowed in this area. So that the all the animals and plants which are there, they get protected. Then this is one of our this only wildlife sanctuaries. Wildlife sanctuaries are places where animals, wild animals can move around freely, and these are protected along with the human settlements which are there inside the areas, and they can do their work of agriculture and all, but that land gets protected and no hunting and all is allowed in that area. Then these are, there is one more very good concept in all over India which is called as sacred groves. Now sacred groves is places where which have religious importance. Okay, religious importance. What happens is, if we are God fearing people, now if somebody says that land belongs to a particular deity or a particular god, then and no plants or animals are supposed to be touched from that area, then nobody will go there. So like this, in our, especially in our northeastern areas like Meghalaya and all, there are many sacred groves which have been able to sustain lots of wild plants and animals which are present only there. They are protected because of this sacred groves. Even in our Goa, we have our Nirankara Chirai, then Siddha Chirai, this side Kepen, we have Paikatsowal. There are so many places which are called as sacred and they are all protected, and that is a type of in situ conservation. Then we have the ex situ type of conservation. Ex situ type means, I told you all, we remove the organisms or we remove the animals or plants from that place and take it to a safe place, and we have zoological parks, botanical gardens, wildlife safari parks, cryopreservation, and in vitro fertilization, tissue culture and seed banks. In case of zoological parks, in other short form it is called a zoo. You must have all visited a zoo once or at least once in your life. So where animals are protected in different cages or big areas are allotted to them, but they are restricted, their movement is restricted, and they are kept in different places where you can move around. That is called as a zoo. Then botanical gardens. The largest botanical garden that is there in Calcutta, that is Botanical Survey of India, there the huge banyan tree also is there with hundreds of plants which were threatened in the wild. They are brought there and planted. They are called as botanical gardens, where plants are brought from somewhere else and they are made to survive in artificial conditions. Then we have the national parks where tourists also can go, but the wildlife is undisturbed. Then cryopreservation technique is a technique of preserving samples of seeds, of spermatozoa and tissues, cells. Cryopreservation is at -196°C, that is liquid nitrogen. It can be preserved for a long time, and whenever required they can be taken back. That is called as cryopreservation techniques, which are used in preserving gametes, preserving spermatozoa, preserving seeds, preserving tissues and all. Also the in vitro fertilization. In vitro fertilization means the sperm and the gametes, female gamete, are made to fertilize in the laboratory condition, and then they are implanted in healthy animals. Then also tissue culture is a technique by which the plants, endangered plants, can be made to multiply and they can be grown back in safe areas. Also, there are seed banks. Seeds of endangered species, threatened species, they are taken and kept in seed banks where they can be taken and grown whenever required. Now, because of all this what we have seen, there are many areas where people have started taking initiatives in protection. Now, this the major step towards protection of biodiversity started in 1992 with the Earth Summit of Rio de Janeiro, and they 150 countries participated in this, and also again it met in 2002 to have the session for making bylaws or making rules for the whole world to follow, so that indiscriminate loss or indiscriminate killing or habitat loss of organisms is not there. There are some rules which are universally followed so that people can conserve biodiversity. So, and also for that, 22nd of May, as you know, is allotted as the World Biodiversity Day by our United Nations. Then again, the efforts that are there, they are continuing for biodiversity conservation, and we are still following that as per, but what is very fresh is 2019 reports are there about 25% of our species are very fast going away from this earth. So, 2011 to 2020 is being made as the UN decade for biodiversity, and now the further one 2020 to 30 is made as a ecosystem restoration decade. So, we have to see that as much as possible we can make this place safe and conserve our biodiversity for our future and for our this. So, with this your topic for this biodiversity is ending, and with all this knowledge, now this type of chapters are introduced in your syllabus, because with all this knowledge you also have to be sensitized as students, and you have to be aware about what actually is happening in this earth. And with these topics what I have discussed today, I hope you have realized the importance of biodiversity and what is happening around us, and also as a chapter for your 12th standard biology Goa board exams. I hope you have learnt from this chapter, and all the best and good luck for your exams also for Goa board. Thank you.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.
अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में, ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर, आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस। अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में, ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर, आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस। अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में, ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर, आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस।